Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good evening. Welcome to another episode of Centering on Peace. And I have a guest, a return guest tonight. His name is Dr. Ervand Abrahamian. He's a historian of modern Iranian history and has had taught at City University of New York for a very long time. I have him back because I want to discuss with him today about some of the current events that are taking place in the Middle East. And of course, the most important one is the war in Gaza, which we are now in the fourth month. And so perhaps we should just say, welcome, Ervand, to the program first.
Hello, thank you. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you for accepting. So why don't we ask first that what are your reflections about the current Gaza war?
Well, I'm actually reluctant to use the term Gaza war. It's a much more of a Palestinian issue. And the focus on Gaza basically distracts from the larger issue. And of course, I think anyone who knew anything about the Middle East expected sooner or later another explosion in Palestine, and much of the expectations was in the West Bank. Now, there has been an explosion in the West Bank, but what has been overshadowed by, of course, is the attack by Hamas from Gaza. And this tends to distract from the larger problem, the Israeli-Palestinian problem. And that's, in a way, it was expected because that crisis was basically kicked down the alleyway for years, thinking that if you just don't address the issue, it would go away. Mm-hmm. And clearly, I mean, if you look at what Hamas did, however despicable and revolting the killings were of Hamas, it was not surprising because what the general perception was in Israel and in the United States was that the Palestinian issue had really disappeared. Mm-hmm. That, you know, the Israelis controlled the situation, they controlled the West Bank, they had isolated Hamas in Gaza. Then there was the so-called Abraham's Accord, in which the Arab states, especially the Gulf states, would normalize relations with Israel. Israel would give them technology. The rich Arab states would put investments in the West Bank. And the Palestinians would be satisfied because there would be nice casinos set up in the West Bank, often financed by Las Vegas billionaires, and the Palestinians would be happy because they could work in the casinos, basically serving the gamblers there. This was the general perception that basically all things were fine. What was going on, because things had been quiet for a while, and therefore the Palestinian issue was no longer an issue. This was the Likud Netanyahu line, which in fact Trump bought. And What was, I think, surprising and really discouraging was that the Biden administration that came in basically continued the Trump administration policy. And this really made the, I think, the Palestinian cause, whether you call it basically the Hamas or PLO, very uncomfortable, because from their point of view, they were now no longer a factor. Mm-hmm. And I think what then Hamas made a calculated move was that they had to break this condescendence, this passivity, and shake up basically the situation by carrying out a major attack on Israel. Now, whether in the attack the atrocities were supposed to be a part of it, or their contingent were something that came out unexpected, I'm not sure whether Hamas intended to have those atrocities, but they clearly wanted to have a shocking attack, take a lot of hostages, and shake up the situation, which they did. And in that way, they have been successful, because you can't now say, well, you know, the Palestinian issue doesn't really exist. It has been solved, and Israel is in the driver's seat, and everything is fine. So in that way, they have been successful. Now, whether the administration in Washington is, I think, shaken enough to force the Israelis to come to an agreement with the PLO about a two-state solution, because officially, of course, the U.S. position is a two-state solution, although they weren't really implementing it. It was being implemented under Obama. Then it was basically negated by the Trump administration. And this administration on paper is supposed to be implementing a two-state solution. Whether they're serious about it, or whether they sort of will play around with the talking about it but not do anything about it, again, go back to kicking the can down the alleyway for the future problems, it remains to be seen. Of course, if Trump is re-elected, we'll go back to the Likud policy of ignoring the Palestinians or trying to crush the Palestinians. If the Biden administration survives, then the question is how serious it would be to enforce that. It would have to enforce it on the Likud government in Israel to actually take practical steps in creating a two-state solution. And to do that, it would have to force the Israelis to withdraw some of the settlements they've put in the West Bank, because by putting in settlements, they're actually on the ground making it impossible to create a two-state solution.
Mm-hmm. Now, a question that came to my mind while you were remarking is, you said that surprisingly, Biden administration continued the policies of previous administrations. Why is that surprising? Since, you know, we have Biden repeatedly, ever since he was a young senator and all the way till now, saying that he is a Zionist and he's the best friend that Israel's got, and he's repeated that many, many times to many people. So one would have expected Biden to be quite aligned with Israeli policies as they evolved, rather than abruptly move away from, let's say, previous administration and move to something else. Wouldn't that be the case?
Well, two answers to that. One is, of course, Biden was a part of the Obama administration. He was Obama's vice president. So presumably he was in tune with Obama policies on Palestine. Second factor is he may call himself a Zionist, but he must be sophisticated enough to know that there are different perspectives of Zionism. There is the Netanyahu view of the right-wing Zionism that never really expected even a limited Israeli state. They wanted a total Israeli state from the river to the ocean was the Zionist, in fact, a right-wing Zionist position. Then there is a Zionist position that was willing to accept some sort of settlement that would be a two-state solution. So hopefully when he says, I'm a Zionist, he was accepting the minimalist Zionist perspective or the liberal Zionist perspective of accepting also a Palestinian state.
How would you respond to the critique of the perspective you're putting out that there is a distinction between, let's say, more messianic, right-wing, settler-kind Zionism and more maybe a liberal Zionism, Labor Party Zionism, whereas in the situation that we had historically, Labor Zionists, when they were in power, they also expanded settlements, just like the other Zionists. So practically, expansion of Zionism, as you already mentioned, would nullify the possibility of a second state alongside Israel on the West Bank and Gaza with Jerusalem, East Jerusalem as its capital, doesn't it?
Well, again, the speed and the amount of expansion was dramatically increased under Likud and Netanyahu. The earlier Zionist expansions, although it was inadvisable, it was often argued on terms of security. It was basically like forts on the line of security on the claims that there might be attack from Iraq or Jordan or something. But there was even the notion of changing the whole demography of the region. Some labor Zionists may have thought in that, but privately. But their official position was often that you don't really try to incorporate what was considered Judea and Samaria. In fact, you know, in the early Zionism, no one talked about the heartland of Israel being Judea and Samaria. It's only recently, after 67, and then increasingly under Netanyahu and the fundamentalist Zionists, that they talk about the heartland of Israel being, in fact, the West Bank. And once you do that, then there's no solution to the two-state solution, because the West Bank becomes the heart of, from their perspective, heart of Zion. But I think the secular Zionists or progressive Zionists or labor Zionists were much more practical. I don't remember Ben-Gurion ever talking about, waxing eloquent about the heartland of Israel being Judea and Samaria. They were quite willing to accept some sort of agreement that would be limited much more to where the original settlements were, which was actually on the coastline and around Tel Aviv. But I think there's a qualitative change with the rise of fundamentalist Zionism, where they say, well, you know, God has given us this territory, and therefore we can't negotiate with it. It becomes a non-negotiable maximalist demand. And that's where I think you have to have real U.S. pressure to be able to get them to actually to think in rational sense of compromise.
Mm-hmm. Now, someone like Ilan Pappe, you may be familiar with, he's an historian, Israeli historian. He's written a lot of books about ethnic cleansing of Palestine, etc. He argues that Zionism has a logic, and that logic is the logic of elimination, because Zionism is a settler colonial movement. And the other logic of Zionism, aside from logic of elimination of the natives, that is logic of dehumanization of the natives. Otherwise, you couldn't go along with the elimination processes. Now, he doesn't seem to be making that distinction that we're making here in terms of messianic fundamentalist form of Zionism and liberal one. He says this eliminationism is the logic of Zionism, regardless of the forms that it had takes. Another person that also puts that idea is Miko Peled, son of the general Peled, who comes from a very Zionist background, with his family being involved in the signing of the Declaration of Independence in Israel, with one of his uncles being president, third president of Israel. His father, of course, was fought in the 1948, from the Israeli perspective, War of Independence. From the Palestinian perspective, of course, it was called Nakba catastrophe. His father was also in the 1967 cabinet as a military general. So Miko Peled argued, and I interviewed him in April in one of these programs. And when I suggested about liberal Zionism versus non-liberal or fundamentalist, he kind of shut me down and said, no, what we are seeing in Israel is the natural evolution of Zionism and quite predictable. Now, that may create an opening for our conversation, because if it's a natural opening to move towards Messianic Zionism, it doesn't mean there are no distinction that you're making earlier, but it just means that in its natural movement in history, it is predictably moving in that direction precisely because of 1967 and the consequences of occupation. What are your thoughts there?
Well, I think the people you mentioned, they would also, I mean, consider themselves actually Zionists, but their criticism of extreme Zionism is that, you know, if you take those steps, then, you know, you're talking about extermination and elimination of the Palestinians. But they're posing their arguments as a critic of extreme Zionism. I mean, there's also Avi Sherlim, actually. I mean, his works are very much on the criticism of the expansionism, and also tied to the notion that Jews should have a state. The question is, you know, the state, should it eliminate by logic the Palestinians, or basically go back to some sort of compromise that was the original UN resolution after World War II of, here you have a land, two nations, both claim that they have legitimate rights to the territory, then the logic obviously is that you somehow divide that area, so both nations have a state. So we're really stuck back into 1947 UN resolution, which was in fact a logical a way of making the agreement. I think the Arab problem was that it couldn't accept it at that time. The Ben-Gurion, the Zionist position, I think it was, more, again, Machiavellian. It was willing to accept it. As a result of that, basically the UN resolution was not implemented. And we're still left with the same problem. Now, I think what's happened is much of the Palestinian moderate movement, the PLO, is willing to accept it. Mm-hmm. And I think the moderate Zionists are willing to accept it. It's what has become qualitative change, as you mentioned, in the Zionist movement, from a minimalist to a maximalist religious position, makes the stumbling block now is really the religious Zionist perspective, that there's no negotiations on this because it's a God-given right to the Jews to have the West Bank.
Yeah, so let me ask you, if you think that the Zionist messianic right-wing Zionism today inside Israel, it used to be a marginal position. Maybe that's the way we are discussing it, but it doesn't seem to be a marginal position anymore. And it seems like quite integrated into the body politic of Israel. And is there any hope to imagine that this formerly marginalized position of these people are now has taken center stage, will ever move back to what it was, marginal status?
I think they, I mean, logically they would need to, for a number of reasons. One is that basically the pressure from outside. It's one thing, you know, the West supporting Israel as a national right of Jews to have a state, to democracy, and so on. But once it becomes basically a totalitarian, fascistic state based on religion, there's no reason for outside countries to have any sympathy for that. Mm-hmm. Another fact, I think even more important, is such a state, we're trying to suppress a large Palestinian population. You're not talking about a small minority, a large, basically makes it a very intolerable living situation. You know, every so often there might be eruption. The daily life is basically becomes impossible. Years ago, when I was talking to actually an academic who had just returned to Israel, this was long before the intifadas, he said, in Israel, you know, everyone is tense. Even the dogs are so intense. You can't approach a dog because they think you're being threatening to. So life becomes so intense that, you know, after a while, people begin to leave.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, what the idea of Israel was to have a normal state for Jews. But if it's not a normal state, it's a completely intolerable, oppressive state, as people find it uncomfortable to even live there, then people are going to leave. And this is already what is happening. I think normal politically thinking Jews will prefer to go back, in fact, to Berlin rather than live in an area where you're constantly on your tiptoes because there might be another explosion the next day. So it becomes not a normal state, but a highly a volcanic state.
Mm-hmm. So let's get maybe a little bit of the definitional stuff out of the way. Do you agree that Zionism is a settler colonial entity or movement, definitionally speaking, descriptively speaking, that it's colonizing and it's a settler colonial form of it?
I mean, it has features of colonialism. I mean, the discourse of settlers of, you know, turning desert into flourishing land and stuff is very reminiscent of course, colonialism. Even the 13 colonies in America, it's very reflective. But at the core, I think it's different from a typical colony. In that the people who are settling there are not settling there on behalf of a mother country. They're settling there because they feel that the so-called mother country is inhospitable to them. They need to have a state to protect them. So there is a rational, I think, legitimate argument in the core of Zionism. But as long as it's moderate or limited, I think it was acceptable. But once it talks about eradication of another nation, then it becomes a different type of, it's no longer a legitimate national movement, it becomes a fascistic type of movement.
So if it's not an inclusive movement, that's what you're saying, then it becomes this problematic movement or state that's based on it, inclusive of other peoples, that is the natives. Let me ask you one other question. Do you think that opposing or denying Jews the right of national self-determination is anti-Semitic? And of course, there's probably another question out of this, you know, does this right exist in international law, the right of national self-determination? Is it a right that's recognized by international law? And secondarily, if one were to deny it to the Jews, is that the same as or equivalent to being anti-Semitic or taking an anti-Semitic position?
Yes, I mean, since 1917, both from the Soviet Lenin and both from Woodrow Wilson, the basis of international politics was to be the right of nations for self-determination. So sometimes this is fudged or delayed or so on, but on the whole, that becomes a legitimate grounds that if a group of people are view themselves a nation, then they have the right of self-determination. So that becomes, I think, it's often used as an argument for intervention, argument for drawing up maps of states. So on that ground, I think to say, well, Jews are not a nation because they're a religion or they're a race rather than a nation. The fact is that a lot of Jews do consider themselves a part of a nation. Mm-hmm. And therefore, to deny that then becomes a denying of, I wouldn't say anti-Semitic, but it becomes denying of basically a right of people to have a nation state. For instance, if you say, well, Serbians are not really a nation, they're just Slavs, part of the Slavic community, and therefore there should be no Serbian nation, this is a violation of Serbian rights, similarly with other nations. So nowadays, of course, some Azeris claim that Armenians are really not a nation. They're really part of Azerbaijan, who've been misled to think they're Armenians and they should really become a part of Azerbaijan. This, again, I would say is an anti-Armenian racial bias. So similarly, I would say, you know, to deny Jews the right of nationhood is, again, a violation of basic international principles of self-determination. But that doesn't mean any criticism of Israel, especially of Likud, becomes somehow anti-Semitic. That's a different discourse that is merged into the politics of Israeli foreign policy to silence people, to say, well, if you're critical of Israel in any way, you are being you're denying Israel the right of nationhood, and therefore you are anti-Semitic. And here, of course, I think there was a qualitative change when Arafat and the PLO accepted the Israel as a legitimate state. And you can't really therefore call the Palestinian movement as anti-Semitic or anti-Israel. It's now the onus has become actually on Israel to accept the Palestinians as a nation. And in fact, as long as Israel does not accept the Palestinians as a nation, it then, I would say, the racism is among the Israelis, mm-hmm. It is hard to find an Israeli right-wing politician who has publicly accepted the Palestinians as a legitimate nation. They can't do that because if you accept that, then the next step is the right of the Palestinians to have a state. Mm-hmm. Which the PLO accepted, but of course Hamas has not accepted.
Are we not locking ourselves into a contradictory position if we say that denying the right of the Jews to national self-determination is anti-Semitic, and at the same time wishing that a Jewish state would be inclusive of non-Jews? If we want to have both of them at the same time, perhaps there would be a compromise position in between, which would be like perhaps looking into other ways in which individuals and communities can express and care for and secure their national self-determination concerns in a polity that is inclusive of others and allows in their political culture for people to express those national identities that they feel strongly about, rather than exclusively creating a state that is Jewish, which seems to me is the heart of the problem and part of the problem that you were describing, the denial of the Palestinian right of national self-determination. Now, if we argue that the Palestinians should have a Palestinian state that's exclusive to them and denies, let's say, the Jewish identity of the community, that would be also problematic. So why can't we have this national right of self-determination not express itself in terms of an exclusive state of a kind of a people, for a kind of a people?
Yeah. Well, I mean, obviously there are two types of solutions to the real problem. One is what I was talking about, a two-state solution. The other one has often been a one-state solution where you have Jews and Palestinians living in one state. Mm-hmm. That would have been feasible basically years ago. But I think nowadays the only way you could have a one state solution is what you already have in the West Bank, which is an apartheid state. Mm-hmm. Which is not an equal communities. It's oppressors and oppressed communities. And you can see this in front of your eyes. The Israeli government is now encouraging every Jew in the West Bank to be armed, basically. They're not going to give that right to the Palestinians to be armed. So obviously you're getting basically a polarized community, worse than apartheid in South Africa, because I don't remember, even in the worst period of apartheid in South Africa, the white government telling all whites to arm themselves to their teeth in order to be able to kill black South Africans because they're seen as a permanent threat. Mm-hmm. So I think that the one state solution is no longer basically on the table. What you could have is the two state solution where the rights of minorities are also protected, mm-hmm. whether they're Jews in Jerusalem or Palestinians in Tel Aviv, they still have certain rights. And that's normal. Most countries have, in accepting the right of self-determination, also are willing to give minority rights to whether it's religious minority or ethnic minority and so on. So in that way, unfortunately, I think when people at one time talked about one state solution, it was feasible because the situation was not that polarized as it is now. And I think the polarization has occurred mainly because of the Israeli move into West Bank, Palestine, and constantly changing the map to make it to in a situation where the two-state solution is no longer feasible. And then people say, well, we have to take over the whole territory. I create a one state.
Mm-hmm. Now, let me press you on that a little bit, using the South African apartheid model. What is the difference between apartheid or Jewish supremacy, regime of Jewish supremacy, as B'Tselem has called it in Israel, between the river to the sea, compared to what apartheid South Africa represented? Why was it that model, apartheid South Africa, was amenable to an exclusive state post apartheid, but not, let's say, the Israeli situation?
Well, the apartheid regime, I remember during the 1940s, 50s, 60s, much of the West accepted the apartheid regime. You know, people like Reagan, Thatcher, were willing to actually tolerate the apartheid. It was once it was became clear that it was basically untenable because of the tensions within South Africa, and of course because of pressure from abroad, especially from the Soviet Union, that they changed their policy, and then the apartheid regime basically stepped down. So it sort of abdicated rather than was overthrown. Here, of course, the situation is somewhat different in that you're talking population imbalance is not the same as in South Africa. You have a tiny minority of whites, huge majority of Black Africans. Here you're talking about a population is much more equally divided and therefore gives the Jews the perspective that they can actually control the situation, which I think is a misconstrued perception, but that's something that's still there. And as long as they have that, it'll be difficult for them to come to a compromise of a two-state solution.
Mm-hmm. The so-called the demographic concern or issue of the Zionism, which is they want to have a state that has a secure Jewish majority, and therefore they're not willing to open it up to equal rights for everyone, because that would, I guess, do away with the Jewish character of the state. If it becomes a democratic state, one person, one vote. Now, let me introduce you again for those of the audience who've just joined us. I'm here speaking to Ervand Abrahamian. He's a historian of modern Iran. And we have been discussing Israel and Palestine issues for a good bit now. I want to move a little bit now in the remainder of our conversation to subjects still related to what's going on in Palestine and Israel today, but not necessarily about foundational questions about Zionism and all that. So let me ask you, do you think there is a possibility that situation in Gaza, a military situation in Gaza, can spread regionally, involving Hezbollah in Lebanon and possibly even Iran? I ask this question because, and you can reflect on that as well, because I know for a long time neoconservatives, so-called neoconservatives in the United States, had this hope or vision or plan that somehow United States will militarily involve itself with Iran in a war. And I know certain parts of Israeli government, perhaps Netanyahu himself, has always been hoping that the United States would do so, attack Iran, for instance. Now, knowing this, that's why I'm asking this question. Do you think that the present situation has the potential of spreading regionally to Lebanon and perhaps even Iran? What do you think?
Well, I think you're right that, you know, that there is been a right-wing element in the United States, the neoconservative, who gave us, in fact, Iraq. And remember, if you go back to Iraq, at that time, the argument was, again, the main problem about Palestine was because Saddam Hussein was supporting the Palestinians. If you get rid of Saddam Hussein, you'll solve the Palestinian problem. Well, it obviously didn't turn out that way. Nowadays, the argument is somehow Iran is behind everything. Iran is behind Hamas, Hezbollah, Houthis, and therefore the core of the problem is Iran. If you can get rid of Iran, somehow the salt problem would be solved. However, I don't think this is going to spread, mainly because I think the regime in Iran, how despicable it is in terms of religious terms, it is actually politically savvy that it doesn't want to escalate the problem. The present problem crisis actually is perfect for Khomeini in the Islamic Republic. Here they say, look, we've always told you the Americans were aggressive force. Israel has no desire to come to any agreement. Here you can see it. Israel is, you know, devastating, making Gaza uninhabitable. They're willing to kill thousands of people. We don't have to give you any propaganda. All you have to do is watch the CNN or watch BBC, and they'll reinforce everything we've told you. So for them, it's perfect situation. Mm-hmm. The only problem, I think, it could be if Israel tries to, in fact, solve the problem on the northern border with Lebanon. and tries to attack Hezbollah there to clear the area of Hezbollah influence, that could then escalate into a crisis. But that would be initiated by Israel. I don't think it would be initiated by Hezbollah or Iran, because they have much, they have nothing to gain by expanding the war. From their point of view, the longer this crisis continues, the worse the situation becomes in Gaza, the better it is from their propaganda point of view. So they, all they have to do is sit tight and enjoy it. In fact, if I was them, I would be breaking expensive bottles of champagne and celebrating. From their point of view, it's perfect.
So what do you make up of the recent rash of assassinations by Israel and by the United States in Lebanon, in Syria, in Iraq, and they're going after presumably senior level officials of groups and movements that are, at least in Iraq and Syria, claimed to be like allies of the United States? Of course, they don't use the term allies in the American discourse. They say proxies, you know. That's one of those things, that the use of language. United States has allies, Iran has proxies, you know, that kind of thing. But putting that aside, the linguistic, you know, distortions aside, so what do you make of the rash of the recent assassinations, both in Syria and in Iraq and in Lebanon, by Israel and the United States? And if you want to comment also on the Kerman explosions that led to 84 or so deaths and many, many injuries in Iran at the tomb of General Qasem Soleimani on his fourth anniversary of his death, and whether or not that is connected to these assassinations, or what we hear that Islamic State has declared that it's it has done the operation, et cetera. So how do you connect those things together? Where are they leading? And why are these states engaging in these assassinations in these various places?
Well, I would separate the Kerman incident. I think that's separate. I think it is an ISIS issue, and that actually it deals with basically the problems of religious politics. If you base your religious politics on Shiism, then obviously you're going to have a counter Sunni approach, and you have enough plenty of fanatics, crazies in the Sunni world as well as in the Shia world. So that becomes basically a sectarian issue, and I think there's probably much more reason to think that it's a from Balochistan, from Afghanistan, the Kerman issue. The other incidents, it's interesting that, you know, the Biden administration keeps on saying they want to contain the crisis, but its ally, Israel, then targets a high official of Hamas, who was not actually involved in the military aspect, but the diplomatic aspect. And also probably is dealing with the hostage crisis. They target him.
You mean in Lebanon? We're talking about the Lebanese.
Yeah. So what I think they're trying to, with whoever okayed that basically assassination, is trying to basically incite Iran and Hezbollah to do something as a counteraction. And I think, as I said, I think the people in Tehran are smart enough to know that the situation is fine for them as it is. Why escalate? The other
assassination, there was another assassination this morning in Lebanon of a very senior official of Hezbollah. So we'll have to see how Nasrallah, Hezbollah chief responds to that.
Again, I mean, I think from both Hezbollah position and Iran's position, sure, Israel assassinates prominent people. So what? You know, there are plenty of other people who will replace it. It's not going to solve the problem. So from their point of view, that they don't have to take drastic action. From their only cost becomes basically their image cost, that they're not doing reacting. there might be pressure from internally from their right wing to do something. But I think the governments are strong enough in Tehran to basically ignore right wing criticism of not doing anything. But they know perfectly well that they don't want to escalate into a full-blown war, because then the ground setting is in favor of Israel and United States, not in their favor.
Right. You could say Iran is interested in, someone used the term, controlled escalation or managed escalation, not interested in a full-scale war, doesn't want to get involved for one reason, because it would be devastating for Iran. I mean, things will be bombed, devastation. Secondarily, because if Iran gets involved, then the issue of Palestine becomes secondary or gets pushed to the margin. Yeah. And this is what you were saying. So right now, Iran, discursively or ideologically, is in a good position. Israel is isolated. United States is isolated globally. Why should there be any reason to change that from the perspective of Iran? But the fact that Israel is doing these sort of assassinations, do you think that Israel wants to push this to some kind of an escalation of a regional war, or do you think Netanyahu is happy with just keeping it as it is with some minor skirmishes in the north?
No, I think the Israeli policy is to try to escalate, but put the onus on Iran, to that Iran is seen as the escalating power, or the Houthis. Or I think, you said Iran's policy is sort of managed escalation. I don't think they want any even escalation. They want permanently keeping the terrible situation as it is there. Freezing. Yeah, continue it.
I see. So what is the U.S. perspective here, or role here? How do you see Biden's role? I mean, on the one hand, the easiest solution to bring things to a halt is a permanent ceasefire. But, we know that the United States has been vetoing and fighting hard with resolution languages in the United Nations to make sure that there is no permanent ceasefire. And at the same time, Vice President of the United States and others go around saying we are fighting Islamophobia, every life matters, a Palestinian child is worth the same as an Israeli child. So there's a lot of talk like that, but we know that the United States has been arming bombs and bullets that Israel is using on the Palestinians, dreadfully, preventing ceasefires. So what is the U.S. vision here? How do you see Biden going forward in terms of also the context of the coming elections in the United States?
Well, this is incoherence in the policy. Clearly it's in the national U.S. interest to have a resolution based on the two-state solution, going back to Obama. But once basically the Biden administration sort of stepped back and let Netanyahu run policy, mm-hmm. and the so-called Abraham Accord, it really became a dangerous situation, because I think people in the State Department realized this was not a wise policy, that things could unravel. And once it unraveled, some people, of course, in the State Department resigned or protested. But still, the policy was that we'll remain staunchly behind Israel. I think because of internal American politics, they don't want to alienate AIPAC. The problem with that is, of course, not supporting ceasefire and following Israeli policy alienates a lot of Democratic voters. So the net result will probably be the end of the Biden administration, return of Trump, and therefore continuation of the crisis as an even worse crisis than before. Mm-hmm.
Why do you think that the strategists for, let's say, Biden administration don't want to reverse their position or secure a ceasefire in order to save this loss of support that you might see from the younger people, the age 18 to 29, from younger Jewish people, including, you know, a lot of Jewish people in the United States are Jewish Voice for Peace, for instance, they're out in the street demonstrating. Do you think that they just kind of view them as lost anyway? They can't get them back. And so we might as well not even think about that strategically in terms of our electioneering politics.
Well, I think there's just lack of willpower, a lack of, you know, a strong personality to be able to change policy. Somehow Biden is incapable of basically making a strong decision about this. And, you know, I think in a way you can say it's lack of, commitment and letting basically the day's events determine policy. Here you have a vice president of the Obama administration who basically remained silent when Netanyahu came all the way from Tel Aviv to Washington to go to the Republicans in Congress, basically sweet talk the Republicans and denounce Obama. Now, Biden was Obama's vice president, and he was willing to accept that. So it's basically a shameless foreign policy, which he's still pursuing. It's hard to have respect for someone who doesn't have self-respect. In internal policies, United States, Biden may have done some good work. You know, I would say, you know, give B plus for U.S. internal policies, economic policies. When it comes to foreign policy, basically he abdicated policy, reversed his own Obama policies and adopted Trump policies on the Middle East. It's not just about the Palestinian issue, including the nuclear issue with Iran. So that's a real mystery why this sudden basically betrayal of his own president, the previous presidency, and adoption of the Republican policy, and not just a Republican policy, but an extreme Republican policy.
And of course, it's not just Biden, right? I mean, you're saying Biden because that's his administration, but there is, you know, Blinken, you know, he has a role. He's pretty active. He's much younger. He's much more robust. He's more cognitively in charge of his thought. So the question is, like, why do the people around him go along with some of these quote unquote mysterious policies? I think even Obama, if I'm not mistaken, recently gave a talk and he said that he was concerned about the coming election, that Trump might return. And he said something like, he hoped that there would be people around Biden that would be able to make strong decisions without going to him or referring to him or something like that. He said, which is surprising to me. So obviously Biden is there, but there are so many other people around him as people who are making the decisions. So it's mysterious to me why they're acting this way. And along with this, you know, I'd be interested in your view about South Africa's case in the ICG, International Criminal Court, charging Israel with genocide. I wonder how the U.S. would respond. I guess my prediction is the United States is going to do everything possible to make sure that it doesn't go the way South Africa wants. But what are your thoughts about that, about the argument of the case against Israel brought forth by South Africa to the ICG?
Well, I'm very reluctant to use words like genocide because it's raises a hornet's nest. You can commit violations of international law. You can commit criminal acts without actually being labeled as genocidical. So I would rather keep the term genocide for a special horrendous offense. As an Armenian, I almost find it ironic that people are willing to use the word genocide on a host of issues. When it comes to Armenian genocide, there's a denial. Israel even denies the Armenian genocide. US, until for 100 years, denied the Armenian genocide. So suddenly everyone is using the word genocide for this and that. So I think what Israel is doing in Gaza is despicable. It's atrocious. It's mass killings. It's disrespect of life. But I wouldn't use the term genocide there.
When would you use it? What should happen for you to say, okay, I'm willing to say this is approaching that?
Well, when there is a determined policy to actually eliminate a whole category of people, a whole nation, like in the question of the Ottomans with Armenians in Anatolia, or the Nazis in Europe in World War II, or the Germans in Africa with the Hutus. There you can say, you know, there was a avowed policy that was implemented to kill out a whole category of people. You could also use it also in terms of the Serbians and Croatians with Muslims in Yugoslavia, but to use it loosely whenever there's an atrocity committed, I think it's this inflation of language and discredits actually very important violations.
Because your emphasis is on the whole of the population. Doesn't the convention, Genocide Convention, says in whole or in part? And some people argue that if you, let's say, cut off electricity, water, food, fuel to a population that's already in a concentration camp, and then you're bombing them on a daily basis, and you're 90 some days into it, and there's infectious diseases spreading, already described as uninhabitable by UN officials, you know, the worst case situations, all that. Doesn't that at least qualify for their getting rid of a part of the population? And that would be part of the convention of the genocide in terms of its definition, no?
Well, no, I think these are all criminal acts, and they should be basically taken to a court as a criminal international violation of acts. But the term, again, genocide, it's a very potent term. I mean, and also, I mean, the Biden administration is partly responsible for the inflation of the use of to label the Chinese government as genocidical because they were putting people in Muslims into basically re-education camps as genocidical is bizarre. Actually, I mean, insult to the English language and legal terminology.
Okay, so we have about 2 or 3 minutes left. So my last question, I guess, for you would be, get your reflections on what some people have been calling neo-McCarthyism in the U.S. with, in the middle of this, whatever you want to call it, war crimes in Gaza, the political elite in the U.S. seem to be much more obsessed with preventing the use of certain slogans like Palestine would be free from the river to the sea, you know, the use of the word intifada, which means kind of like uprising in Arabic. And then you had the spectacle of the heads of the Ivy League universities called to Congress, and then now a couple of them had to resign behind the scene use of billionaire money. Some people say billionaire Jewish money, etc. So what are your reflections on that? Do you accept it as a fair description to say this is neo-McCarthyism and the criticism of it?
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting that I see insecurity of people who support Israel, that they can't tolerate any criticism. So even to words that are considered sort of threatening, like intifada, or that they don't realize the term river for the ocean was actually a Zionist slogan, which the Palestinians have adopted, that you can't use this type of words because they have supposedly other meanings. It sounds actually very Orwellian, that you have to control every word because the words, nowadays, of course, the twist about already is that these words may make other people uncomfortable.
Mm-hmm.
So what?
I mean, what does it say about our political system that the political class, while completely being isolated globally and being directly complicit in the war crimes in Palestine, seems to care most about making sure that campus politics and student organizations don't use slogans like Palestine will be free from the river to the sea. What does that tell us about what kind of political culture or system do we have, or the elite politicians?
But to me, it reflects the insecurity of the elite, that they can't even tolerate certain words, as if the words are going to unravel the whole situation. They realize, I think, that before they could always argue legitimately, well, Israel is a democracy, Israel is doing well, and so on. And now that Israel is no longer democratic, becoming a fascistic state, apartheid type, then it becomes much more, the elite becomes much more uptight about it. It can't tolerate even stepping out of the discourse. And in the, I think in the universities, of course, there's another line, another issue is like a long-term issue, which is people who give money feel that they have a right to dictate what goes on. And often that much of the writings about campus politics, they deal with a lot of, you know, issues of freedom of speech and stuff. But what they don't get to the core of the issue is, what is the legitimacy of someone, billionaire, who gives money to any university to dictate what the university should do? Why should that person actually have the right to interfere in the university campus? Basically, they're trying to control thought and teaching and behavior in the universities because certain donors feel that their money gives them the right to actually dictate what people should think.
On that note, I want to thank you. Oh, go ahead.
This is not a new issue. I mean, I think that the Palestinian issue has brought it to the surface, but for a long time, we could see in the universities, people who have nothing to do with the university merely give money are dictating, and they've become more important because over the last 20 years, state money to universities has declined. Yeah. So universities become more dependent on billionaires who mm-hmm. then are trying to exercise their according to them, their freedom of speech and silencing other people.
Yeah, thank you. I guess it's part of the neoliberalization of universities, too. So I want to thank you on that note for joining me. It was interesting and hope to see you back.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I hope in better times.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.